Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for coming to this, the last event in this year's Research Group on Constitutional Studies lecture series. The Research Group on Constitutional Studies is a unit of the Yan P. Lin Center for the Study of Freedom and Global Orders in the Ancient and Modern Worlds. RGCS itself spans faculty, postdocs, graduate students, and an undergraduate fellowship in mainly philosophy, political science, and law, bringing together scholars to work on questions about the nature, values, institutions, and principles that govern societies, seeking to engage in work that combines normative, historical, empirical, and legal analyses of the fundamental governing institutions, rules, and norms that make up our social orders. The Yan P. Lin Center, established last year, is an interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary center spanning 12 departments across 4 faculties, dedicated to the study of social orders in especially normative and historical modes of inquiry, bringing together scholars from classics and history, from architecture and urban planning, from political theory, political science, and law, aims to provide a new space at McGill for, broadly speaking, humanistic social science, aiming to study the ways in which societies interact across international boundaries, comparisons across eras from ancient to modern, and comparisons across regions spanning the whole world. Within RGCS, which pre-existed the Lin Center, this lecture series examines the values, institutions, and principles of a free society, with a special emphasis on bringing scholars who are leading researchers, very often interdisciplinary researchers in the social sciences, law, philosophy, and history, spanning at least some subset of those, to McGill to present work derived from their research in a way that is broadly accessible to the student body, such that current research on the values, institutions, and principles of a free society can be shown and taught in ways that are not segmented off, only accessible to faculty and graduate students in specialized research seminars, but rather that draw on the teaching ability of our leading researchers in those disciplines to introduce ideas into the broader intellectual life of the McGill student body. It is a special honor to be able to welcome to the RGCS lecture series John Ferejohn, Samuel Tilden Professor of Law at New York University. Professor Ferejohn is one of the most honored and distinguished social scientists of his generation and has been a leading contributor for more than 4 decades to the analysis of institutions and constitutions, looking at the ways in which norms interact with the incentives faced by individual actors who make up those institutions. As a contributor to the so-called positive political theoretical analysis of institutions, he has often been involved in the use of methods derived from economics to analyze political mechanisms. But he has done so in a way that is especially and distinctively, first, methodologically self-conscious and self-aware. He's often written on the philosophy of social science of the use of the kinds of tools that he has been importing into political science and then later in his career into law, as he studied the outcomes of lawmaking and constitution-making institutions, and also to the normative principles that such analyses implicate. Accordingly, by himself and with collaborators and co-authors, he has published in the leading journals of multiple disciplines, not only leading law reviews and a number of times in the American Political Science Review, but in the Journal of Philosophy and sat on the editorial board of Ethics. His contributions across political economy, political science and theory, law, and philosophy have been recognized each in their own distinctive ways as being important contributions to the shape of the study of politics and law in those disciplines. He holds a PhD from Stanford University, has been on the faculties of the California Institute of Technology, of Stanford University, and now for some time of New York University, with appointments that span political science, law, the Hoover Institution, and more across those universities and institutions. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, a former Guggenheim scholar. He is someone who, in his research by himself and in his reaching out to scholars working in allied fields, exemplifies the kind of work that we aim to encourage in this research group and in this lecture series. Please join me in welcoming John Ferejohn.
I'm interested in democracy, and I'm still interested in democracy 40 years later, and I haven't figured it out, as you will see. I told Jacob when I gave him some options about what I might present here, and I said, this is a paper I'm struggling with, and so I need advice. So hopefully I'll get some from you people. It's very much welcome. So anyway, you'll see the central issue here is what I would call public or collective deliberation, but it's that idea is approached from a more or less empirical or practical point of view, in the sense that I don't think of deliberation theory as I developed here as an ideal theory, as Habermas and others have developed it, but it's rather a descriptive idea about what actually goes on in the world. So if you start from that point of view, you recognize that what is going to count as deliberative processes can be pretty rough, ugly, political, and very distributed across different places and different publics and different institutions. And so I'm going to try to think about that, but I'm going to start at the beginning with a conflict between my former colleague, Ronnie Dworkin, and my current colleague, Jeremy Waldron, dealing with different views of deliberation, really, I think, about and centered on the question of which institutions are better or worse at deliberating about what to do collectively. And so I'll start with that. And then I will characterize what I think are the value conflicts that animate some of their disagreement and position them descriptively in a certain way. That's when I talk about equal concern and respect as separate values. Then I'll talk about what I call folk democracy, and I'm going to characterize that as a political struggle that has, at the same time, it's not only a political set of struggles that span hundreds of years, but it also carries with it an implicit deliberative theory, which I will develop a little bit, very briefly. And then I'll give a conception of deliberation, which draws roughly from Aristotle's notion of practical reason. That's why that's in the title. And to some extent also from decision theory, which I'll explain in a few minutes. And then I'll give us a couple of examples to do this. Now, this will all happen in how many minutes?
50 to 55.
Okay. Okay, fine. I could talk really fast, so. Okay, so I think, I'm not sure Dworkin invented the idea, but he spoke of democracy as embodying two central values, what he called equal concern and respect. But he spoke of as the two values as though they were one values or instantiations of a single underlying value, which is political equality. So his idea was equal concern and respect go together, right? And so that, and he had ways, which I'll talk about in a second, of showing how they go together in a very attractive way, a number of essays that he wrote. What I think they're separable, and I'm going to argue for there being separate values, but you know, Dworkin's univocal value theory is a powerful theory, and I want to take it seriously. So for those of you who don't know it, I'll say very briefly what it is. So the idea, as I understand equal concern and respect, and I'll put it back into Dworkin's terms in a minute, is equal respect and concern are both dignity interests that people have. That is, you know, we're entitled to be treated with concern for our well-being and our welfare. We're also entitled to respect. I think those are two separate things. I think they're both dignity related, but they're separate in the following way. People are entitled to concern for their welfare or well-being. They're entitled to that whether or not they're citizens. They're just persons, they're entitled to that. They may have differentially powerful claims depending on lots of other factors, but I think of it as something which doesn't have a direct notion of agency involved in it. It has to do with people as sources of value, and that we should treat them as sources of value. That is to say that if someone will be made worse off by some action we take, that is a reason not to take the action. It may not be a decisive reason in the end, but it's still a reason not to take the action. And everyone has an equal claim in that respect to have their welfare or well-being treated on a par. The other value, equal respect, is, I think, a claim that people have ought to be treated as though they're fully capable of being agents, to take actions, to fulfill roles of being citizen or actors in deciding what to do to direct their own lives, actually in private life, to jointly help direct our public lives. So that is a different kind of claim. It's a claim that it's a power claim, really. It's a claim that people ought to be, presumably entitled to some kind of equal power or recognition of power or agency, something of that kind. And now Dworkin basically said, no, these are two aspects of the same value. That's what his value monism was. So he said, basically, it amounts to this, in the case of democracy, it's that we ought to understand the political value of equal respect. We ought to interpret it as people are entitled to as much respect as they, only so much respect as is consistent with equal concern, put it that way. In other words, this is part of an argument against treating majority rule as implied by democratic rule. In other words, he wants to say that those people who think majority rule is per se democratic are wrong because that's to amplify equal respect by giving everybody a vote, an equal vote, and counting it equally and mechanically adding them up and determining social decisions in that way. He recognized that to do that often would lead to failures of collective equal concern, that is to say the majority could take actions that would disadvantage some people, and that the equal respect tends to sort of slide into a mechanical majoritarianism, and he thinks Dworkin criticized that. And so he said, no, what we want is to have accord people equal respect up to the, as long as, insofar as that's consistent with achieving equal concern. That's, in effect, in my view, to relegate respect to the second class. It doesn't make it an instrument merely for equal concern, but it makes it a secondary value to equal concern, right? And so there's something to be said for that, but I'm not convinced that it's consistent with democracy in the way Dworkin puts it. So here's, So I want to, in this paper, I'm going to treat them as separate values. I'm going to say that respect is important, concern is important. At some level, they'll occasionally have to be traded off one against another. There's no question about that because they're sometimes in conflict and we can't have them both. But insofar as we trade them off, for a value monist like Dworkin, he says that it's not, well, let me just back up and say it a different way. He considers the case of judicial when a court strikes down an act of a legislative majority, right? And let's say they do it correctly. That is to say, the court judges that a particular law transgresses some fundamental right or constitutionally protected right, and it strikes down the statute on those grounds. Dworkin says there's no grounds for respect, for regret, for that happening. That is to say, the legislature got it wrong, the court fixed it, they got it right. No reason for regret. My view is that if you recognize concern and regret, concern and respect as separate, freestanding values, you wouldn't come to that conclusion. You'd say, well, yeah, from a moral point of view, there's no reason to regret that the court struck down a statute that inflicted a moral wrong on people, But there is a different reason for regret. I would call it a reason for democratic regret. That is to say, it would have been better Had the statute not been enacted, had the legislature been able to deliberate to a position where they'd see, in advance of enacting the statute, the prospect of a moral harm being inflicted on some people and refrained, right? So that's the object of regret. So there's regret, you know, but it's not moral regret. So my view is you can have moral regret or democratic regret. You can have both. They both can occur. Dworkin doesn't have the apparatus to recognize it, right? So I want to say that we should recognize democratic regret. Many of the criticisms about judicial review are exactly about that. So I want to say that that's an argument in favor of value dualism, at least in this case, or pluralism, if you want to put it that way. So that's where I'm going. So now I want to step back and think about respect as a political claim or fact or object of struggle. And this is the theory of folk democratic practice. So I want to see historically the claim for people for political recognition to have rights or power historically is a struggle. It's been a struggle. You know, it's usually often not given up easily by people who at the moment in time have control of power. They don't usually like to give it up. And so you have, you know, the history of, let's say, British parliamentary institutions, that's called winning the initiative, I think it's called in some of the historical literature. You know, it's where there was a struggle between the crown and parliament in the 17th and 18th centuries to win the capacity of commons to inaugurate legislation or to control budgetary claims that might be made by the crown. So, and it's a struggle, and there was often fighting, you know, and it's not the kind of thing that gets given up very easily, you know. So we have to understand, I think, when we're thinking about respect claims, that they have historically been objects of struggle, and they're not likely, they're going to have a facticity to them, which is a hard-edged facticity. You know, so that when Dworkin comes along and says, oh no, we should only accord so much respect as is consistent with equal concern, we should recognize that, oh, that entails people giving up hard-won fights. Is that where we should be starting our thinking, right? So I want to say that, you know, the idea of folk democracy is the idea that people have expectations about what they're entitled to do collectively. And those expectations very often say, you know, that I'm entitled to a vote. You know, and when women win the vote, women are entitled to a vote. And me as a woman, I'm entitled to a vote. When African Americans finally, you know, won effective rights to vote in the second civil rights legislation, each of them was entitled to a vote. Secondly, it usually meant equal voting as far as districting and, you know, how people were gerrymandered into districts. And it also entailed usually a claim for something like majority, right? I agree with Dworkin that it's mistaken to see majority rule as the only possible democratic way of ruling. There's a powerful claim for majority rule that's not so easily compromised. You know, and I think Dworkin's view, the value monism, leads him to see the compromise as easier than it actually is. So I want to say that from the folk democratic point of view, you know, majority self-rule, let's put it this way, self-rule either as individuals or as individuals in communities, let's say small communities, or in larger communities like states or provinces, and still larger communities governed through something like majority rule has a powerful claim, right? So in American history, and I'm not sure it's true, well, I haven't systematically looked to see how true it is in other places, this fight could be seen in the struggle between the framers of the American Constitution and their opponents, conventionally called anti-federalists. And the anti-federalists, you know, the folk democratic theory on my account would say, well, first best for an anti-federalist point of view would be if we rule ourselves directly. You know, that is to say in town meetings. It's the kind that Tocqueville found when he visited the United States. That would be first best. But of course, the anti-federalists at the time of their framing and founding the Constitution didn't really think that was feasible. So they said, well, okay, if we have to have representation, that would be okay, but we want really small districts and we want really short election terms, right? And so a lot of the fight between the framers of the Constitution and their opponents was how big did the districts have to be, how small, you know, how frequent are elections, right? So So that was a lot of the struggle. So the presumption in folk democratic theory is the closer to the people, the better. The smaller the district, the better. The more frequent the returns to the hustings, the better. So that's the kind of the notion. So it's the folk democratic theory has this idea that delegation of authority or representation are to be given grudgingly. You know, it's based on suspicion of power of elite power. You know, so the basic folk democratic belief is delegate very grudgingly, as little as you have to. Make sure the people you delegate to come back pretty often, right? So that's the basic practice, and I think that practice, you see it over and over again, in at least in U.S. history. You see it whenever there's a populist surge. You saw it like at the end of the 19th century with the rise of these farmers' movements rebelling against industrial forces. You saw it with the populists in the late part of the 19th century. You saw it again with progressive reforms like the creation of the initiative and the referendum process and recall. And we're seeing it right now again, incidentally, in the United States in any event, in some other places. So these are manifestations of folk democracy, and they're episodic, but they make claims, and they're powerful political claims that demand recognition. So that's folk democratic practice. Now let me talk about folk democratic theory. So as I said, folk democratic theory, while it prefers government by the people, close to the people, by themselves preferably, it recognizes, as I understand it, as I read it, the necessity for delegation or representation. And so how is that supposed to work? Well, I sort of said already, which is to say, if you've got to delegate to an elected official, he's got to come back pretty often to the district and explain why he should be sent back to represent you, right? So he's got to explain, right? So accompanying a delegation is a demand for explanation, for justification, you know, for apology. Right, so the normal, in folk democratic theory, when you delegate, you know, in one direction, power in one direction, you expect justification to come back to you, right? So if you see this in terms of the structure of government, if you delegate to a representative, an elected representative, then he's got to explain to you. If he does something jointly, you know, with his colleagues in the Congress, he's got to come back and explain to you why he voted what he did and why the Congress did what it did. If they in turn delegate to an agency, well, the agency has to explain to the Congress and to you that is in public, and your representative has to explain to you why they delegated to the agency, and why the agency, what the agency did was defensible, right? So if you think of the structure of government as first the people, then the representatives, elected representatives, then the agencies, then the courts, then you see that the theory of folk democracy, as I explicated, is one in which delegations go from people, representative, agency, courts, you know, well, in that direction, and justifications have to come right back down, right? And so my claim is in folk democratic theory, it's actually pretty structured. That is to say that the justification expected is in proportion to distance from the people. So judges are required to give better, more complete, more systematic explanations than agency people are. And agencies are required to give more complete explanations than members of Congress are. Right, and this is embodied in many practices, and I could go on to, at least in the American context, many examples of how this is true in legal doctrine. I'm not just making it up. I'm making up a little bit of it, but I'm saying that there's plenty of reasons to think that the justificatory burden is heavier the longer the distance is between the people and the agency which has received these chains of delegated authority. So you see where I'm going there, which is to say, if it's the case that even this naive, you know, primitive folk democratic idea, even if that's a primitive idea, it has already the seeds of a theory of deliberation. Seeds of deliberation are the demand for reason giving. That is to say that the demand that delegated power is exercised, there has to be an explanation. Go one step further, the explanation given back to you ought to track the reasons given for exercising the power in the first place. In other words, if it's found to be the case that somebody exercising delegated authority has given one reason internally for doing it, for exercising authority that way, and then it's found that they give you a different explanation, that would be grounds for some bad thing happening to them, withdrawing the delegation, impeachment, things like that, right? So there's gonna be a discipline between the reasons publicly presented to the people who gave you the power and the reasons for which you took the actions in case, you know, the actions inside the agency or inside the court. So that's already developing a theory of deliberation in a sort of very sketchy form. It doesn't say what the content of deliberation is, but it says that if you're going to take an action based on delegated authority, you better be able to give reasons that are satisfying in a certain context, which means you better be able to shape the actions you take in a way that they're explicable. In other words, the actions that are taken in the agency or the court ought to be the kind of actions that could be given a rational and public explanation. Right? So already there's the sketch there. So I want to say that even though this primitive notion of respect, equal respect, which is, in my view, the object of this struggle that's embodied in folks, democracy, already carries with it a deliberative idea. And so what's a deliberative idea going to be about? Well, on the way I started the talk, you can see I have two values in play, concern and respect. That's it. That's what they're concerned with. They've either got to explain to you that I'm exercising power on your behalf because I respect the judgment that you gave me when you sent me to office, or else I'm doing it for your own good. And here's the reason, even though you don't think so. Right? So it's roughly going to be one of those two forms. Right? So now, I'm not making the further claim that there's no other value. I'm not addressing that at all. So somebody probably could come up and say, well, you missed number three here. You've got two, but there's actually three. And I'd love to hear it, but I mean, I'm not addressing that. So, all right, so that's the basic structure. So let me just take one more segue into what I take to be practice. Again, in the context of the American state, but I don't think it's particularly unique to the United States, but it certainly, you can see it there pretty well. So I did a book a few years ago with William Eskridge called Republic of Statutes. And the argument in that book was in favor of a practice, what we called the book administrative constitutionalism. And the claim there was that in order to realize, well, that to understand the workings of the administrative state, we had to understand that Congress and administrative agencies are in the business of creating what we called small c constitutional rights and instantiating them in various ways. Some of them were, you know, are ordinary, you know, rights that are of the kind you'd protect in the large c constitution as well, and some of them are different. They might be social or economic rights. I mean, the fights over healthcare were, in my view, essentially about whether or not there was going to be a social or economic right to healthcare, and it's not doing too good right now, but we'll see how it works out. So, in the longer run. So in the book was mostly about how it is that administrative agencies actually engage in rights creation and rights protection, right? So what it focused on, this is before I thought about this project, was effectively on the deliberative processes that go on inside of agencies and between agencies and congressional committees and Congress in general, and between agencies and courts, in fighting over and developing rights in various areas. And we focused on rights to non-discrimination rights in employment, what's called Title VII law in the United States, voting rights. We had nine different areas we did this in. So you know, it's all over American government. You find just lots of cases in which most of the serious moral thinking that happened at the agency level, and often in dialogue in between agencies and Congress and between agencies and the public and agencies and courts. But the fight was almost always about, at least in our book, about how it is that a right would have evolved and become refined over repeated arguments. I'm going to give a further example later on, but that's what I would call pretty standard practice of American administrative government, you know, the way it, I think it's probably true in many other countries as well. I'm sure it's true in many places in Europe. So I'm going to be thinking about that being, that's kind of a background subject I'm going to talk about. So now I want to talk a little bit about deliberation itself, all right? So, and this is what I'm drawing from Aristotle, what I call Aristotle's theory of practical reasoning. So Aristotle, in the ethics, the idea of practical reasoning was, you know, sort of very simply given as a kind of a syllogism. You know, somebody has an example, you know, I want a beer. That's a major premise. There's a beer in the refrigerator. That's a minor premise. Get the beer, drink it. The conclusion was drink the beer, you know, so you just go to the refrigerator and drink the beer. So it's, you know, end means, you know, so an action. So the trilogy, I mean, people have criticized in philosophy this trilogy because one line of philosophy says, well, people don't, you know, practical reason doesn't always result in an action. Sometimes it results in an intention or a practice or a policy, you know. So we need to widen the scope a little bit. It can't just be that the only possible conclusion is an action. So that's, you know, that's fine. So it could be a policy or an intention or a plan. Michael Bratman at Stanford has done a lot of work along those lines, and many other people have done too. So then there's the question of, okay, but on the face of it, even making that amendment, it looks at the first stage that at least the initial theory of practical reasoning that Aristotle developed looks very much like what we call instrumental reasoning. That is to say, the major premise is given the status of major premise, that it's the end, right? But, you know, if you read further into the ethics, you see that Aristotle begins to loosen up that story towards the end of the book, you know, and in which there gets to be a reconsideration of ends, at least to some extent. And there's a wonderful book that was written a few years ago by Henry Richardson called Practical Reasoning About Final Ends. Some of you may know it. And it's to give a lot of consideration as to how to think about how it is, using the syllogistic approach of Aristotle, practical reasoning understood it that way, to think about how it is that final ends might be called into question. Right? And so at that level, the book was a theoretical book. He wrote another book later on called Democratic Autonomy, in which he develops it in the idea in a much more concrete way, in a more collectivist way. So I'm going to get to that in a minute. But for right now, I'm going to start with that Aristotelian point of view, where we're going to take ends as initially as the major premise, means as minor premises, and then we're going to try to think a little bit about how to think about final ends in a way that we could make headway that Aristotle probably didn't think you had to make, but I think I have to make. So often when an economist thinks about practical thinking, he's very comfortable with the first formulation I just gave you in it from Aristotle, that it's, oh yes, the ends are just given, you know? In fact, many economists think it's incoherent to think seriously about revising ends. On what basis would you do that, you know? So, and I think that's not a productive view, because I think we often find ourselves in practical situations where we pursue an end for a while and we learn more and more about what it entails, and sometimes we give it up. And sometimes we moderate the end, or we slightly deflect it. We do things that we adjust the, we don't take ends as actually as fixed as some of the sort of more religiously oriented economists might take them, you know? And in fact, there are many economists who don't take this view, so I'm going to talk about one in a minute. So I want to think about ends as flexible, so I need a framework for thinking about that. And so the framework I give in the paper is called preferences as opinions. The idea is simple. That is, rather than thinking as, economists often think of preferences as ends, right? So that's what you want, you know, what you want is a given, you know, and you have unique access to it. Nobody else can tell you what you want, so it's a subjectivist view, you know. So my idea is that, no, let's not take preferences as given. Let's take your interests as given, all right? Now, of course, we can't directly observe your interests, but neither can you, right? So, but you may have opinions about your interests. Let's call those your preferences. So preferences will be opinions about your interests. Now, it's true, you know, in many contexts, it could be true that a person has a lot of insight into their interests, right? But not all the time. You know, so economists often think it tends to be true in consumer domains. You know what kind of toothpaste you like. what's good for you. Maybe you do, maybe you don't, you know. But in other domains, like collective domains, I think it's more problematic whether we think individual people or the people together necessarily have a very tight grasp on their own interests. And we can see many practices that arise both in consumer behavior and in citizen behavior that suggest people don't believe that. You know, the market for consumer reports, what's that about? It's about thinking you don't know for sure what you want when you think about buying this or that, so you try to get advice, you know, and you know, so it's sometimes from experts, sometimes it's from people who are like you, but you want advice. So I want to say, you know, if we see preferences as opinions, then we could recognize that what you think you want, you know, could be wrong, you know, and so the posited end from a syllogistic point of view is defeasible. It could be wrong. In other words, you could learn things about what's entailed in pursuing an interest you think you have, that is a preference, and it could lead you to revise your preference. Now, probably you could revise, interest could be revised too, but I don't have the mechanics to think about that at the moment. Right now, I'm just going to say that people may very well have interests. They may be relatively fixed compared to what preferences would be, but preferences are going to be a little bit more open to revision, right? So now it'll make sense in a decision theoretic sense to think about adjusting preferences in light of new information, right? So, and I think if you consider it, it's completely common in everyday life. You know, we learn that, you know, something bad happened to baby formula, demand for baby formula by people declines. I mean, that's normal, right? You think I like that stuff? No. You find out something bad about it, you decide you don't like it. So we do adjust our preferences all the time, and we do adjust them collectively. So that's the idea. Now, the two examples in the paper of this that are interesting, you know, one is Rousseau's theory of the general will. Those of you who are political theory students, everybody reads the general will and about the general will and social contract. And so there, you know, Rousseau said the general will is part of every person's will in his community. Right, so it's in there. It's in each of us, right? The trouble is a signal-to-noise problem. You know, you got your private will too. It's very powerful. You know, when you confront a choice situation, you have powerful impulse to fulfill your private will. The general will's in there to make a little noise, but it's kind of swamped by your private interests, right? So Rousseau thought the problem was to find a way. In his case, it was a procedural way to set things up so that when people decide collectively, they might have a pretty good chance of hearing collectively the general will, even though no individual could hear it very well themselves, right? So that was kind of one idea where they set, so the general will, in my view, would be interests. Belief about the interest, the opinion about the interest is what you think the general will is. You're going to tend to be, you know, a pretty erratic judge as an individual of the general will. Rousseau thought there is some chance in a suitably structured community with a suitably structured agenda that people could collectively hope to make a good judgment about the general will collectively, right? Some people think that Condorcet's theory of majority rule was one instantiation of the possibility of doing that. So that's an example from political theory. Another example is from Gary Becker, an economist. It's called the theory of hedonic consumption, where again, Gary Becker thought there's some things that people, that are in people's interests, in my terms, he would call them basic values, you know, and the commodity space that people operate in, that is what they buy and sell, that's really complicated, and it maps functionally into the space of values, right? So that and the connection between in this mapping, that is between the commodities and the values, it's uncertain. You know, that is to say you have beliefs about that, but it turns out you could be wrong. You know, and new information could come to light which would make you change your preferences over commodities in order to more efficiently achieve these basic values. You can actually see traces of this as well in Rawls's theory of primary goods and theory of justice. So this idea of separating preferences, what people think they want, from what their interests are, is, you know, it's reoccurred many times. I think it's a natural way to think. So I want to think about deliberation as, you know, partially, sometimes it gets right down to the level of interests. Of course it does. People have different opinions about, you know, that. But often, it has to do with arguing about these complicated mappings between the alternatives in front of you and the things that are actually in your interest. So that's how I'm envisioning practical reasoning. It's reasoning about means and ends, but where the things that are putative ends, that is, which are, for example, you know, like in the American debate about the Affordable Care Act, wanting to have, you know, affordable care for a lot of people, for the maximum number of people, that would be an end, right? And then the different parties disagree about how to achieve that. You know, the Republicans think that there are private sector alternatives that will achieve it better. I have trouble seeing that, but they do. They think this, you know. So they're arguing about this, and so you know, presumably, hopefully, you know, if people experiment with these different means, which we're in the process of doing in the United States, they may come to revise their views about these, about whether it's possible to do these various things. So practical reasoning would, the ends, you know, the putative ends that are being sought, like achieving affordable health care for many people, would be something that, you know, would be revisable. That you decide whether or not that's worth seeking. I think many Republicans think it's not worth seeking at all. So, nothing against Republicans, but that's just saying. So, all right. So that's the theory of practical reasoning, and that's the, you know, it's an Aristotelian theory where there's an option to review ends, and I've tried to give it an idea of how it would be a coherent idea to revise ends if you take preferences as opinions. And I think you could see how that would ramify through other institutions. So now I want to go back to equal respect. So remember, I characterize equal respect as an achievement, a political achievement that was fought for, and that is not as easily compromised as Dworkin thought it could be. And so I want to pick up that thread for a minute. So you could see one way to understand the history of many modern polities, including that of the United States, is as successive waves of demands for equal respect on the part of groups, you know, usually disenfranchised groups, people wanting the vote, wanting to be able to stand for office. All right. So initially, when the Constitution was ratified, I think more than half the states had property requirements. You know, so within about 20 years, most of them had attenuated or disappeared. So that the first struggle was to remove property requirements and allow a much wider electorate to evolve. So by the time Tocqueville arrived in the United States, the electorate, you know, it was white and male, but it was large, you know, so much larger than it was at the time of the founding. So that was the first kind of struggle for the franchise for white males, you know. And so, you know, you'd see it also with the Civil War, after the Civil War with the 15th Amendment, a struggle in the South to enfranchise African Americans. Didn't work very well for the most part. You saw it with respect to the women's suffrage, and later on in the Second Rights Revolution with African Americans with the Voting Rights Act, which worked better. All right, so there's kind of an arc of these struggles, and you could find it in many countries. You know, if you look at enfranchisement across Europe, you'll see that the franchise is very small in the early 19th century, and by the mid 20th century, it's very large. It's not unique to any particular country. Every democracy went through this kind of history. But one thing that's true in the United States, maybe true in other places, but it's definitely true in the United States, is that as the struggle went on, it won, in addition to rights for different people, it won judicial intervention in those rights. And so we've had in the United States development of what is called democratic law, the law of democracy. Law of democracy concerns voting rights, gerrymandering, campaign finance, whatever regulations there are concerning political parties. You can imagine, if you know anything about American politics or political structure, that it's going to be complicated because many of these things are state-level concerns because the framers decided that states would regulate the franchise for the most part and the districting and everything. So the law of democracy is a complicated system that ramifies in different ways throughout the federal system. But one thing it has in common is that judges have been playing an increasingly important role, especially since World War II, right? And in the United States, again, this is inside baseball, you know, a critical moment was when judges decided in the reapportionment decisions in the early 60s that the political question doctrine was not going to be an impediment for them intervening in many of these cases that previously they'd left off the judicial agenda. But now they're heavily involved. So this means that when you think about equal respect, it used to be the case people go to the barricades and fight and demonstrate. They still do this, you know. But some of this is on automatic pilot in judiciary, you know. So something happens and suits get brought. You know, you don't have to fight. You know, you have to fight, but you fight in different fora. You know, and judicial decision making plays an increasingly important part. And I think that has real serious consequences for the equal respect norm, because it means that it can take on, and it has taken on, in my view, in the United States anyway, quite brittle forms. People who study campaign finance see it very sharply, which is to say that, you know, one of the ways in which the judicial development of equal rights has gone is that they've taken the right to free speech and made it so formidable that effectively it permits very little campaign regulation. You know, so that means effectively that if the people want to rule themselves in a certain way by having campaigns structured in a certain way, they're not able to do it, because the speech norm, as it's understood by judges nowadays, in the last 30 years, has been such that it's very difficult to enact a campaign finance regulation that will be constitutionally sustainable. So that's just one example, but there's other examples where in the early 60s, among the first actions was to require that state legislatures, both if they have two chambers, they both have to be apportioned on the basis of population, whereas prior to that, you could have one chamber that was population apportioned, usually the lower chamber, and then the upper chamber, the Senate, could be apportioned in some other way, often by county designation or something. But in any event, the Senate districts could have different populations. So effectively, all the states that had bicameral legislatures, which is all the states but one, which is Nebraska, adopted population apportioned senates, you know, which made the senates a whole lot like their houses, like their lower chambers, right? So now, was that a good thing? There were other alternatives which were not considered. I mean, one alternative would have been to do what many other nations do, which is to say that, well, if you can have a senate that's not population apportioned, we'll just reduce its power. You know, as they do in Canada's like that. I mean, most other countries have the Senate have a different and lower amount of power than the lower chamber does, precisely because they're not population apportioned. That did not seem to be a remedy adopted by anyone. And I think it was substantially channeled by the judiciary in this way. So it's another brittle version of equal respect. So the actual shape of equal respect, you know, has been shaped increasingly by judges in ways that may be not good. Right. So another one, which I think is actually it's possibly more important than the first two. The first two are, we can't regulate our campaigns. That's really important. Secondly, we can't really think flexibly about how basis of representation, because the interpretation of states have been that the only way to comply with judges' rulings would be to have equal proportion senates. The third one is, what's happened to political parties? So, the United States political parties are very peculiar. They're not membership parties. I'm sure most of you know this, but one way to understand many of the struggles for equal respect is, historically, at least in the 20th century, have been against party elites. You know, so for example, the requirement that most states have of for primary elections is to remove the influence of the smoke-filled room. You know, which basically, over a period of time, has led to a situation in which the parties don't control their nominees. That is to say, if the nominees are able to sort of, you know, put together on their own pretty much campaigns that are somewhat party independent, and so parties in the United States are uniquely easy to take over. You know, so we don't. I mean, so people complain about the absence of third parties in the United States, but third parties are irrelevant in the United States because you can take over a major party. You know, so why bother? You know, so. So, and it's, you know, that's been true for most of the 20th century. People don't get exercised until they saw Donald Trump, but it's been true forever. So we have parties that have names, you know, they have people who give money, but effectively they're captured by candidates, you know, and they're captured at different levels. So it means that, you know, we don't have capacity in the United States because of this, the way in which courts have implemented the equal respect norm, to have you know, serious programmatic parties, you know, that would develop ideas coherently when they're out of office, and then the same people would show up afterwards and when they get into office and begin to implement ideas like that. You see a little bit on the Republican side, but on the whole, it's very difficult to do this. In fact, you see how ephemeral it was when Trump came in, got the Republican nomination. Now, of course, he's fallen to the line as a Republican, but it wasn't a given that he would have to do that. I mean, he could have just pursued the policies that he actually said he was going to pursue when he was campaigning, which was to be a big government guy with, you know, a wall, you know, big government with a wall. So, but lately he's been implementing most, or at least trying to implement most of the Republican agenda, and we'll see how far that goes. But the point is, he took over. And it's not the case that it's very easy to control a guy who takes over a major party. And it's the reason it's easy to take over is these impediments that have been put in place judicially based on the equal respect norm. So here you have this equal respect norm that I've talked about all along. I think it's hard-edged. It's powerful. It's been picked up judicially, you know, and it's not going away. It's going to stay that way. And it's distortive of our practices in ways that interfere, I think, systematically with achieving equal respect, equal concern, I mean. Right? So that is, insofar as we cannot formulate coherent party platforms and fight over those platforms as though they're real alternatives, it's going to be more difficult to implement equal concern. So I think that's a lingering problem with the development of democratic law. So that's what I'm going to say about that. So now the final thing I want to talk about is back to deliberation. How am I on time, actually?
10:15 left.
Okay. So so that was the bad news. So now I want to talk about practical deliberations, back to what I said a few minutes ago about the book that Eskridge and I wrote on Republic of Statutes. But it's going to draw an example that Henry Richardson developed in his book, Democratic Autonomy, where he was applying his neo-Aristotelian theory of deliberation to a particular policy sequence having to do with what became the Americans for Disabilities Act, but it started out in a very different way. So, and it's illustrative of what I would say practical deliberation concerning both, mostly equal concern, but you can see reflections of equal respect in the story as well. And it's, so I'll go with that for a minute. Okay, so what happened was there was a freshman congressman in New York named Mario Biaggi, ended up in jail incidentally, but not for this. Anyway, he was a freshman. With every freshman, usually you win in a contested election, then you want to make yourself safe, so do something that makes you popular at home. So he was promoting an amendment to a mass transit bill, which basically said that, it was vague, but it basically said that disabled people ought to be able to use mass transit. And the importance of it was that this was going to control, or was directed to the agency that dispersed funds to states and localities which built transit systems, bus systems, subways, stuff like that. So it said that disabled people ought to have, and elderly people ought to have access to these things. So the agency, the Department of Transportation, got this amendment, which the bill was enacted. It was a great big bill. The amendment was a little teeny amendment. So, but they got all the language, including the amendment, and so they began to figure out what would that mean. You know, so they, you know, an agency takes it seriously, so there's deliberation inside the agency. And they said, well, you know, we could do this by, they considered retrofitting existing systems, you know, buses and subways, really expensive. They said, well, that's kind of a non-starter. So why don't we just hire a bunch of vans and have a system of on-call vans available wherever we give out money. And so anybody who's disabled or elderly can just call one of these vans wherever they want to go. Much cheaper, right? So that was the idea. So everybody will have access, but it'll be sort of separate but equal access, but it's kind of access. So that was fine for a while, but then manifestation of equal respect, a lot of complaints from the disabled people. Elderly people liked it, incidentally, you know, the interest groups, but the disabled people, they didn't like it very much. So there starts to be, their representatives are complaining, you know, and there's another act of Congress called the Rehabilitation Act, I think about 3 years later, And its agency wasn't the Department of Transportation. The target agency was what used to be called Health, Education, and Welfare Agency. And there they put forward, I think, the idea that there's something that if we're going to accommodate people, we should do it via mainstreaming as far as possible. Mainstreaming means the disabled or elderly should be able to use the same means of transportation that everybody else does. And of course, the argument on behalf of the disabled people was separate vans are stigmatizing. So we want to have, so mainstreaming was, so it got built into the 1973 bill. So now the Department of Transportation, which has had this other, you know, the vans idea, right? Their general counsel, smart person, she knows things are going to be in court any time now. You know, there are two agencies, they don't normally talk, you know, but the general counsels pay attention to stuff. So she began advocating. She says, this is coming. We've got to get on the mainstreaming bandwagon. You know, so the general counsel at Transportation basically persuaded the high administration in lots of joint meetings with the two agencies that she initiated to basically develop a mainstreaming idea. So basically what went on was first this little amendment that came out of nowhere. Then the agency tried to take it seriously, provoking an interest group outcry for stigmatization, and then provoking eventually a new legislative reaction. So you see there's deliberations going. How's it going on? It's going on in one agency, first in DOT, then between two agencies via the general counsel, because she's a lawyer and a very good lawyer and pays attention, right? Then provoking a new act of Congress, the Rehabilitation Act, you know, and then there's a series of other actions that ultimately results in the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is a much more complicated act and a much more serious attempt to implement this idea of mainstreaming as far as possible, retrofitting systems. It's more expensive, for sure. So the goal that was originally understood by the Department of Transportation was do this the least costly way. The goal that was subsequently understood as the actual goal was mainstreaming. That is, you know, achieve equal access in a mainstream way. So it was not cheap, the cheapest possible way, it was the mainstream way. So that evolution is what I would call it's an ideal but a real example of a deliberative process. The things I want to point out about it is notice how distributed it is. You know, it happens, you know, in Congress initially with the amendment. God knows why it passed. I don't know why it passed. You know, probably it was cheap. Look, at the moment in 1970, a freshman puts it up there. Okay, you're a good guy. I'll let you have this. You know, then there's deliberation. You work out what the consequences are of pursuing a policy of any kind. Then you go between agencies, then back to Congress, then back to agencies. So it's and judges are looming in the background. If you fail to do mainstreaming by a certain point, everybody knows it's going to be litigation. You know, so, and of course, the municipalities that are getting the money, they're willing to sue too for other things. So I'm saying that, so the kind of deliberation I'm pointing to now is one in which it's very distributed, it does involve judges, it does involve Congress, but it principally involves agencies. That's the way in which it sort of dovetails with the view we developed in the Republic of Statutes book about administrative constitutionalism. So I can tell very parallel stories in other areas, but this is a pretty good idea of how it is that a real theory of deliberation, a theory of real deliberation, put it that way, you know, has to accommodate the way it actually works. And this way it works, in this case, exemplifies the fact that ends were adjusted, you know, the means were, you know, new means had to be brought on board because the original set of means were not big enough. You know, you had to think about retrofitting once the van idea went away, right? So there's that idea. So now how does that come back to the original thing, right? Remember the fight between Dworkin and Waldron where I started? I mean, here, those of you read it, as I put it anyway, Dworkin's idea is judicial review is a good thing for two reasons. One is judges have a special capacity to deliberate in ways that further equal concern. I didn't say that, but he does say that. Secondly, when they exercise that power, assuming they get it right, there's no reason for regret, by which he means moral regret, right? Waldron, in his work, gives many examples where he claims that parliaments or legislatures are very capable of deliberating as well about equal concern. He gives examples from in his book and in many other essays from England and New Zealand and places, other places, about exemplary forms of legislative deliberation. He doesn't say anything about democratic regret, but he could certainly claim that it would be better, even if you could do judicial review, it would be better to do less of it, right? So, but actually, when you see it in terms of these developments of how actual deliberation happens, you see that the argument really isn't necessarily between these two high-level institutions, the court, by this Dworkin means the Supreme Court, and the legislature, by which Waldron, since he mostly writes about, well, he mostly thinks about England and New Zealand, even though he writes about other things. It's a peak national level legislature. You know, often the real action is happening someplace else. So it seems to me that what we're thinking about real deliberation, and we're thinking about the two species of regret, moral and democratic regret, we ought to be thinking about it in this distributive way. So when we look back on the Richardson story, you know, inside the agencies and the disabilities case, I think we have to see that as a case in which, well, as far as I know the case, we don't have reasons for moral regret. The reasons we don't have them is the agency was capable of deliberating effectively, the agencies, deliberating to a place which was a reasonable place to end up in terms of equal concern, that is actually making it possible to a large extent that disabled people would have full and equal and mainstreamed access to transportation means. Now, of course, that was not complete because, you know, a municipality could build a transportation system without federal money, in which case they don't have to do this, right? So there's an incompleteness to it, but you wouldn't say there's, as far as the Department of Transportation could deal with the problem, there's a reason for moral regret. I don't think there's a reason for democratic regret either, because the central role was played either by congressmen to some extent or by their people they delegate power to, namely the agencies. And so I think there you'd say that the circumstance was one that actually worked out pretty well. There are going to be bad examples too, incidentally, so I'm not going to bring them up. But so that's the idea. So the idea is we had to accept that deliberative capacities are distributed across many institutions, including courts, legislatures, and especially agencies, and that a real theory of deliberation has to recognize what goes on in those deliberations, and here I think it's very important to recognize that ends are refined, changed, respecified during deliberation, and that's a necessary component. So now let me just, that's the idea. So let me just think of a couple of objections, just off the top of my head. So one would be that this theory concedes too much to democracy, all right? So that I point to agencies, those are kind of democratic two steps away, that is, it's not the people, it's not the legislature, but it's the agency, you know, so it's, and secondly, I've already said that the development of equal respect is, its claim to authority is partially factual rather than normative, so they say that we can't take it away from the people without a rebellion, so, you know, so, and given the judges have picked up that baton and pushed it forward, there's kind of brittleness put into the system, which I think is true in the United States. So you could say that insofar as you're giving examples of deliberation in the American system with its distorted idea of equal respect, then you're probably not doing as well as you could be doing, which I agree with. That's one problem with this theory, is it may be too accepting of the way in which the equal respect norm has imposed itself on the world. That's possibly true. You know, I particularly regret the fact that we don't have real political parties in the United States. So that's... So that probably has many consequences, including the fact that we don't have a real welfare state. So another example, another would be that it's too statist. So far, all the examples I've given are ones in which the entities doing the acting are state actors, right? So you'd say, is that a necessary component of this theory? And I would say, no, it's not. In the United States, it may tend to be that way because, as I said, that political parties are not very effective for the most part. But of course, there is civil society and many interest groups that play an active role, and we could see it in the story about transportation where the disability interest groups played a very active role in pushing alternatives and things like that. So I don't think it's necessarily statist, but I think in the United States, it tends to be a little more statist than it would have to be were it not for the equal respect norm having the shape that it currently does. And the final one is that, is it genuinely deliberative? Now, this is one that like Simone Chambers would raise this against me. She said, well, how could it be a deliberative theory if civil society isn't doing the deliberating? You know, and so Now, notice I haven't had civil society directly doing any deliberating at all, really. I mean, they have election campaigns, you know, and then you have this equal concern issue, which is that everybody's entitled to these things, but not that they're entitled to make their own laws, exactly, as Rousseau might have wanted. You know, so the whole development of the theory is to recognize that different institutions and organizations, both in the private and public sector, have deliberative roles to play and give a good example about how that could work, like in the transportation example. But it doesn't involve full democratic deliberation in the way that Chambers would have wanted to say, that's true. You know, now, so there's a question about how far could we go in that direction of getting a fuller democratic deliberation. And I must say I'm skeptical about how far you can go that way in a large, complicated society. So I guess my defense would be it's not as fully democratically deliberative as Chambers and maybe Habermas, I'm not sure, would want. But I don't see how in a complicated society we can get all that far that way. And this is better. And I think it's a better description of what's going on. And I think it's a better defense of much that goes on in agencies and Congress than others have said. And so secondly, the one deliberative aspect that's there, though, which I think is important, which is it recognizes how ubiquitous dialogic processes are in actual politics. So, you know, within the judicial area, people talk about dialogues between courts, meaning Supreme Courts and Congress, but you can see from the Richardson example that dialogue happens right through the system, I mean, right down to the bottom. You know, and the dialogue doesn't just involve governmental entities, it also involves civil society entities and others. And so, you know, I think, and sometimes there are active civil society-wide engagements, and so I think it's not impossible to happen on some issues. And so I think actually there is a case to be made that there's a fair amount of opening in this kind of idea for society-wide deliberation, but I don't think you could say that it develops it as far as it might be wanted by Simone and Jürgen Habermas. Thank you.
We have about 15 minutes for questions. When you ask a question, please turn on the microphone in front of you. The red light will go on. When you're done with your question, please turn it off again. And at these lectures, the first question is reserved for a member of the Research Group on Constitutional Studies Student Fellowship.
Hey there. Thanks very much for the talk. My name is Mark. I'm a fellow and a second-year law student. I was just curious about whether, and I don't know the American context particularly well, but I was curious about whether you've thought at all about suspended invalidity in judicial review, and particularly in a Canadian context, often when the Supreme Court strikes something down on constitutional grounds, they do it on the with a suspended invalidity, a period for the legislature to rectify the law. So a recent example is about doctor-assisted dying. But long way around to say, it seems to me as though when the court does that, after hearing your talk, it seems to me as though maybe what's going on there is a kind of expression of democratic regret. That they're elevate. Well, I think you understand the gist of my question.
So, I didn't know this case, but I think of Article 33 as that kind of expression of a different this what's generally called soft form judicial review as an expression of the importance of having democratic institutions take the decision, even if they do it with a gun at their head. You know what I mean? So that's. And that's not putting it the way a Canadian would put it, I know, but still. So I think that's right. So how do you do suspended validity on doctor-assisted suicide? I was curious. They just keep killing people until for a while? I mean, it's curious. I mean,
So it's a criminal code for...
You're irreversible about it.
Oh, is that
right?
So you do that?
Okay, fine. Just curious, okay. So I agree with you. So.
Nick Cowan, I'm actually at the NYU Law School as well at the moment. So it's great to see you talking here. But I don't want to misrepresent your position. position as offering something like an enormously positive view of this kind of state agency led with sort of judicial rights approach. But I thought I'm tempted to kind of push back just a little bit more in terms of some of the bad impacts that has had. And I would contrast it a little bit with the sort of approach you tend to get in the United Kingdom, which I think doesn't really have equal concern and respect fundamentally. It's a bit more utilitarian. So there is a sort of push towards, say, including people with disabilities. But, you know, and disability organizations tend to be a bit worried about this. They find that judicial outcomes tend to be quite disappointing. They don't push quite as hard as you know, these extremely costly impositions that you can get in the States. But one outcome is that it does mean that things are a little bit cheaper. You know, it means that these and one thing is in the United States in particular, it is very, very bad to be poor. And that's going to like reduce access to an awful lot of services, which may technically fulfill disability requirements, but because of that, are necessarily much more expensive. So I just wonder: I just worry that this system of with state agencies being pushed by particular lobbies could be a bit more chaotic than you're presenting.
This could be a bad example in the sense that you're saying that the requirement that to get federal money, buses have to be retrofitted so that disabled people can get on the bus and get off the bus, things like that. So, and that does raise the cost of transportation, and it probably means there are places that don't have public transport that would otherwise have it because they can't afford to pay that or whatever. You know, so in other words, it probably raises the cost of both ends. So I'm not defending. I mean, I'm not defending the outcome simply. I'm saying that I was taking this to illustrate a phenomenon. Whether you think it's good or bad seems to depend on the value you attach to the different aspects of the case. So if you think the stigmatization argument as really gets something very deep and demanding of respect by disabled people, then you might weigh it differently than. I mean, it's true that some people aren't getting access to transport, and they don't know who they are because, of course, those buses don't exist in places where they couldn't be afforded. So I see the trade-off you're making, and I'm not defending the current thing. I think you have to weigh those things and decide how to come out on it. So.
I was actually thinking of, I think your example is good, but I was thinking of an even more extreme example. I think it was UCLA had all those public lectures that they were going to like provide, but because they hadn't subtitled all of them, there was a lawsuit that just took them all away.
Yeah, okay,
so
yeah.
That was like one example where it just seems to be like a kind of fairly, kind of like blunt leveling down that's kind of going on.
No, there's no question that does happen. You know, and I know a lot of good examples. I don't have some really clear bad examples. I mean, under Title VII, that pregnancy discrimination was an interesting story. You tell the same story. Again, it was agency developed. The court played a more active role back and forth. And then finally Congress came in and said, no, they actually enacted a Pregnancy Discrimination Act, which is an amendment to Title VII. But, of course, that did impose costs on places, and there were consequences economically elsewhere. And, I don't know how to evaluate them, but, So I'm not defending it as a pure normative. I mean, I'm really defending it on the following grounds. This is what happens. We need a deliberative theory to recognize what's happening before we can actually get to the point of actually assessing it very well. So that's what I was aiming to do. So.
Hi, thank you for the talk. So if I understand you correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, so you're suggesting a process of deliberation between institutions rather than directly involving the civil society as like, ideal deliberative theorists say, because you want to make it a more practical concept. So now, if that's your position, my first question is, in democracies where constitutional institutions are laid out by separation of powers, there's often competition between institutions for power itself. And in that sort of situation, like especially if you place I mean, historically, the judiciary and the legislature. How do you see? I mean, what is your vision of deliberation there? And I mean, because ideally, deliberation means like coming to some sort of consensus, or and if like you think there can be deliberation between institutions which are fighting for power between themselves, like do you think it can like solve the problem of democratic regret beyond it being regret? Because the idea of deliberation is to involve the voices of people who do not normally get voices in institutions. And moreover, if you restrict it to institutions where they're not actually fully represented, like what is the point of this deliberation, which is, I mean, how is it moving very differently from what our democracies are working as of now?
Well, I can talk from here. This is true. I think the deliberative practices I point to, I think, are imperfect, maybe very far from perfect, right? So I completely agree that if there are people who are not included, that's bad, you know? So I agree with that. So I'm not thinking of deliberation as necessarily aimed at consensus in the way you put it, though. I know that, you know, many theories of deliberation put it that way, but this theory says deliberation is about collective deliberation about of all of us, in principle, is about what we should do together, right? Now, what we should do together depends on what reasons we have for doing things, you know, whether or not any particular one of us believe those reasons. We have reasons to do things together. In fact, none of us might know the reasons we have to do things together. You know, so whether we agree is a different point. It's like, I mean, it turns out a whole kind of epistemology that Habermas developed, which it doesn't seem to apply to, in my mind, to the world. Deliberance is about deciding what to do on the basis of reasons. You know, among the reasons there are the welfare of all the individuals. That's what equal concern's about. You know, that is to say, you're entitled to have your interests taken into account. Whether you can say that out loud or not is a secondary, it's not an issue, actually. You're entitled to that. If we fail you by failing to take your interests equally into account, that's a failure to you, whether you articulate it or not, whether you agreed or not, you know. So you could agree to things on my account that you should never have agreed to, you know. So I don't want to say consensus plays any particular role in my theory at all. I mean, consensus is nothing to aim at. You know, especially when you think people's views about their interests are possibly wrong. You know, so there's some things where an expert might be much better at knowing your interests than you are. So that's why I just don't get into the consensus theory of deliberation at all. I think it's not the right theory. I have other criticisms of that too, which is Habermas makes this very sharp distinction between public and private interests, which I think is just untenable. It's like, you know, let's say, from a Rousseauian point of view, it could be in our interest to have a highway in our country. But what about a particular highway? You know, there was, okay, we should have a highway. If you put it someplace, it's going to transgress on some people's interests. So and that would be true for any particular highway. You know, so you could say it's in our interest to have a highway, but any particular interest involves burdening some people more than others. Well, it's relevant to making a decision about whether to have a highway how people are being burdened. That's what equal concern demands. You know, so to say that you can distinguish speech, you know, in the way he distinguishes, you know, community of action, the way he distinguishes it between public regarding and private, it's crazy. That's impossible. These things are mixed together in the world, you know. So I don't think that theory starts, you know, so what deliberation is taking actions for good, for reasons. That's all it is. You know, so, and when it's deliberation for all of us, it's for all the relevant reasons. The reasons that are relevant for us are dignity interests and welfare interests. Those are the interests we have. We're entitled to equality because we're all citizens you know, if we are citizens in the same place, we're entitled to be equally. So that's my theory of deliberation. It's not about consensus at all. So, and it's a defect of any deliberative process that it fails to take account of somebody's interests. Absolutely. So if someone's interest doesn't get represented because, for example, people like them are not on that agency, that's a bad thing, on my account. It has nothing to do with consent or not consent. It has to do with their interests were not taken into account, you know. And so I have a way to speak to what I think are the morally relevant aspects of deliberation, but I don't think consensus is a morally relevant aspect of deliberation. Because I'm a, you know, you can see my theory of preferences as opinions sort of cuts out a lot of this stuff.
I'm going to ask a question in the voice of someone who I'd hoped was going to be able to make it for the final part of the Q&A, but isn't, and that's our provost, Christopher Manfredi, who is also a faculty member of the research group. As you might know, given your reference to Section 33, there's a way of talking about judicial review, and particularly the softer forms of judicial review in Canadian constitutionalism, that treats judicial review as a kind of dialogue, and that emphasizes a dialogue metaphor for what happens when the court strikes something down, puts it back into the parliament's court, parliament tries again, passes a new statute. And Provost Manfredi has famously cast doubt on this metaphor, partly asking, is this remotely falsifiable? You have one agency acting, the court. It acts to the utmost extent of its power. Then that is followed by another agency acting. So things happen. Afterwards, the apologists for judicial review, as he would put it, characterize that whole sequence as having been a conversation. But how do we possibly distinguish that dialogue, or on your characterization, the deliberation among agencies from, well, one agency acts, and then another institution acts, and then another institution acts, and at the end of it, something has happened, because, well, things tend to happen. But there wasn't ever a moment of formal, official exchange of reasons. This is part of the point for the Habermasian constraints. Yeah. If there's never a moment of coming together as equals without a decision being prejudged by one party's power, then, well, you just have a sequence of actions. You don't ever really have a deliberative or dialogic moment. Or do you? Is there some way you can empirically distinguish deliberation happening among all these institutions from just one thing happens and then another thing happens?
I thought you were going to do the gun at the head thing. Because that's the other way. So that you know, you guys are too young to remember Jack Benny. You know Jack Benny? You know, he's a comedian. He was famously cheap. So at one point, a robber came up to him and put a gun at his head and said, "Your money or your life." And Jack Benny's just standing there, and the robber's getting sort of twitchy. He says, "Didn't you hear me? I said I'm going to kill you if you don't give me the money." And so Benny's still quiet. He says, "Well, can you turn over your money?" He says, "I'm thinking about it." That's how cheap he was, right? Anyway, so I have some examples which don't come to mind immediately, but have exactly this form where the court says, it wasn't Canadian, I think. The court says, "We're going to do X unless you do something." It was in Israel, actually. "We're going to do X unless you do something. I'll give you a year." So there was a debate, went on for a year, and they did something toward the end. You know, but the point is, it was clear, the court, it was Aaron Barak, you know, the justice there. He just said, you know, "This is wrong, what's going on now. I'm going to fix it. You know, it's better if you fix it. I'm giving you some time, fix it." You know, so he fixed it. So that would be dialogue, kind of, right? I mean, in the sense that he sent a message, they heard the message, they acted. Now, of course, he didn't ask their opinion. That's true. So it was very stilted dialogue. And so I agree from a standpoint of communication, there appear to be defects, right? On the other hand, I think it's an open question from that description. I'm not sure, I'd have to have an example of yours, remember I have these two kinds of regret, democratic and moral. Let's stipulate there's no moral regret, let's assume the judge was right, you know, right, in striking down the statute. You know, but is there democratic regret? Well, I think there is possibly a case for democratic regret if what confronted the legislature was, it's going to happen anyway. You know, so we could do it, in which case we'll have legitimized it in a different way than you would legitimize it by doing it anyway. So we might say, but still there's something wrong there. I agree with that. Right. Now, in your case, we have a statute struck down. Is that what happens? Under Article 3, so notwithstanding clause is not invoked, right? What's the order?
No. Yeah.
So it just strikes it down. The legislature could reenact it, or
the striking down is suspended. This would be
original. Oh, like that? Okay, so suspended. Okay,
they say to Parliament, you have a year to repair the constitutional defect,
and
pass a new statute.
Right. Okay.
The apologies for judicial review afterwards will say, look, there was a conversation. Some parliamentarians will say, no. You told us in pretty fine grained detail
that's
what
the gun in the head. That
yes.
is the gun in the head.
Yes.
That's right. Yeah.
Right.
So, okay. So,
why is that dialogue? Why is that deliberation?
No, well, so when I said at the very beginning that I wanted this to be a realistic theory of dialogue, realism means everything's imperfect. So, there's no question it's imperfect. That is to say that there's, as I said in this case, there is some claim to democracy. Somebody's hand is up, so keep it in my mind at the back. So, we'll get to you in a second. But, it's just that your head was directly this way. So there is a reason for some democratic regret there. Maybe not moral regret if the right decision was made, right? So the democratic regret would be that the legislature couldn't come up with it themselves without being forced to, right? Or what? Or that the court ought not to have had this. I mean, how would you characterize the regret? I would say, assuming the court got it right, that the regret was that the legislature passed the statute to begin with that had this defect. Would have been better had they not done that. Nobody would have had to draw the gun. They wouldn't have had to act under duress. Or is your description that the defect was not that, it was that the court should not have been in a position to actually offer that choice to the legislature, or the kind of choice, the quote-unquote choice, the non-choice? What do you think? This is a third form of regret.
The complaint is about the misdescription. Mm-hmm. You say that part of your point in calling this deliberation
is to say you are giving us a sense of what's going on, that there's an exchange of reasons. And Manfredi says, if we cannot empirically distinguish that from one agency wielded power and ordered another agency to do something, then it's not clear what's gained by the description of it as using these various conversational metaphors.
Okay, so I guess I'm back to the answer that I gave to the young woman in the back, which is my theory of deliberation. It's drawn from Aristotle. Aristotle, the whole book in the Ethics is about individuals, right? So deliberation is about how to decide what to do, right? My theory of collective deliberation is just taking Aristotle and applying it to groups. So it's how should we decide what to do together, right? What that brings in is that different individuals have different private interests and possibly they have shared public interests, right? So, but still the object of practical reason, which is to, is to get to the right answer, right? Now, that's not a communicative theory, right? So this could all, I mean, it might be better if reasons are exchanged, and it might be more effective for taking the right act, the best actions, that reasons are exchanged. I think that's often true, because I think it's a fundamental fact about doing things together is when we do something in our collective interest, it burdens different of us differently. And how are we going to know how it burdens each of us differently unless somebody says, it hurts me. Why are we doing this? Now, the answer could be, there's no other way, and we thought about it, but the point is, there's a demand for communication on my theory, but the communication is not the central part of it, right? So it's really a practical reason as a theory, reasoning as a theory of deliberation. In fact, there will be deliberation. It will always be defective. And in fact, usually the practical reason will get things wrong often. So I guess it's just not that kind of a theory of deliberations. So.
Hello, thank you for your talk. My name's Brian, I'm a fourth year political science student and I'm with the RGCS Student Fellowship. So some of my ideas are taken from Professor Philippe Lagasse from Carleton University, but I was wondering what your take on this was. So in Canada, I'm not too familiar with the case in the States, there are certain powers that are deliberated very little on, and I bring the specific example of the war prerogative. In Canada, the war power, the power to declare war and send troops, is almost exclusively the executive's power. There's no need for a legislature to approve anything for it. And the Supreme Court and all of the judiciary has been very, very reluctant in dealing with any cases that have to do with the war power of the executive. And indeed, in 2008, right before the 2011 elections where the Harper government was elected, it was one of the first times the executive actually brought the war power to the legislature, even though the legislature didn't, de jure, they didn't have any power over if the Canadian mission in Afghanistan was going to be extended or not. And so the legislator voted on it and approved it. But afterwards, during the 2011 election, any time this question of the war powers brought up and the extending the mission in Afghanistan, the executive used it as kind of, oh, the legislature approved it, so therefore it was through a democratic process. We were not doing, the conservative government was not doing this unilaterally, and so we don't have to discuss about it for the election. I was wondering if extending the war power to be more deliberated through judicial review or through a more formal means for the legislature, is this something that you see as more beneficial for especially a power that's so important to the Canadian constitutional system? Thank you.
Yeah, this is, I've written a little bit, not about Canada, but about things like this, where not so much about war, but about emergencies, you know, where a number of countries have emergency powers that confer on the president, confer on presidents or executives the capacity to act and actually derogate rights and do things they couldn't otherwise do. So, and explicitly without consulting the legislature. So it's like that a little bit. They're never used. You know, so you look at what happens when there's an emergency in these countries, like in France, you know, with the murders, you know. What happens is Hollande went to the legislature and got authorization. You know, like when the federal executive of the United States wanted to go to war in Vietnam, he got the legislature to enact the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. So he could point to, and then with the invasion of Iraq, they got the Patriot Act and the authorization for military force. So there are these various acts in which executives purposely try to bring the legislature in precisely to share the blame. You know, also because, at least in the United States, and I imagine in Canada, don't they need the legislature to appropriate money, to give money for the process? So if they've at least voted on going in to begin with, then they might be a little more pliable when it came to giving money. So now what to be done? I mean, I think that's another thing. What I'm saying is, I think this is a common practice where executives often want to share blame, you know, and involve the legislature. So now what would be the alternative? So now in Canada, as you said, constitutionally, the war power is a monopoly power of the president or the prime minister. Is that right? Let's say it is, okay. Yeah. In the United States, that wouldn't be true. I mean, at least nominally, Congress has the power to declare war, right? Although we've only had 5 total declared wars in the history of the United States. Believe me, we fought a few more than 5 wars. We're in war every year, as far as I know. So I'm just saying that de facto, I mean, now, so first of all, there's the question about whether imposing the requirement would be effective, you know? But then, even if it was somewhat effective, as I said, I think presidents or chief executives often want to involve a wider group of people on his or her side. So it's not clear that they would not just go around it. So I don't know what would you propose as an alternative? I mean, what would you think should happen?
I'm not too sure, but I was thinking, like, if this door for the war power should be open to judicial review specifically,
okay.
And would that, do you think that would bring more deliberation within the process to open up other alternatives, yeah. Ways where it's not just the crown prerogative that's declaring war, and perhaps this, yeah, is not necessarily representative of what the people want?
Well, the United States, there's been efforts in Congress and elsewhere to control what the president does in terms of using military force. So the famous one was the War Powers Act, which was enacted at around the time of Watergate you know, with a very, very weakened president, so they got it through, you know. And I forget who signed it.
Was it Ford? It was repassed over Ford's veto.
Of his veto. So there's a very weakened Republican president that got that through. And that has a bunch of requirements about when exactly, how much force, how and for how long a president can do things on his own without going to Congress. And presidents of both parties have always claimed that those restrictions are unconstitutional. And they've always more or less complied with them, as far as I know. And so they've effectively mooted court action because they've done, under protest, what the act requires, which they claim is unconstitutional. So it seems to me, in other words, to get a court to be effective, there would have to be some change in the incentives of the executive. Because my guess is the incentive of the executive would be about what it is now, which is, yeah, let's bring in the rest of the legislature. There won't be a court case because who's going to complain? So I don't know if it would really, I mean, standing by itself, unless you had somebody to bring the suit, I don't quite see where it's going to come from. So
I'm afraid that we're...
I just want to say one thing, and that is the fact that this was a minority government, and so it's quite a different case from what the norm would be.
Thank you.
I'm afraid that we're a couple minutes over time, so I apologize to the people whose hands were still up. I'm going to invite people to join us in the atrium outside for a reception, and maybe some of you who had outstanding questions will have a chance to follow up the conversation for the next little while. People who are on the list for dinner, please assemble outside the glass doors at the end of the atrium at 6:40. And then we'll proceed to dinner from there. Everyone else would still be welcome then to continue with the reception here. And with that, thank you very much for coming out, and please join me in thanking John Ferejohn.